Grüß dich, Herr Dr. Allerberger. Genau, für heuer den pathogenen Tag.
Marie, just a question to you. Can you see my presentation right now? Can you see my screen?
Yes. Yes, I
okay,
can see
perfect.
Your screen.
Because it's the same for me. I cannot see it as well right now. So I was unsure. Okay, perfect. Thank you. So then let's start. Just 3 minutes ahead, behind the schedule. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening all around the world. Thank you very much for your great interest in today's Foodstar webinar about biopreservation of foodstuff, mechanisms and applications on a very high-level topic of food technology. Before we start, we will have some small information about the project EU Foodstar, which was funded by the European Union. And of course, as you know, the European Union has a demand on dissemination, and therefore we would kindly give you some information about the project, and you will also receive some technical advice to follow our webinar. My name is Julian Drausinger. I'm a food technologist based in Vienna in a private nonprofit food research institute. I have also some years of experience in product development, and I will be your moderator for today's afternoon. And here is the agenda once again. You have an introduction, how to use the control panel. You will get some small slides about the Foodstar project. Then we will have the presentation you are all urgently waiting for. And if you have questions during the presentation, I kindly ask you to send me these questions via the chat window I will introduce right after the next slide. And you will also have the possibility to give us some quality feedback, some evaluation about the webinar, about the presentation and its contents after we close the webinar, or you can also send us an evaluation email later on. If you have some other topics you would like to discuss with us, or you would like to get into contact with us, please send an email to office@iseki-food.net, and our secretariat will be more than happy to help and assist you. So for the technical introduction, you see here the screenshot of the control panel, which is commonly located on the right side of your screen. You have some technical buttons here. You can minimize the panel. You can view the webinar in full screen. You can raise your hand if you have some technical difficulties to follow us. And there is the micro unmute button, which is currently not in operation because we would like you to follow the webinar, which means your micro is unmuted so that we do not have background noise and disturbances from the participants. And as I mentioned, here you have the questions area. It may look a little bit different in your version or not. Of course, in this dashboard, you have here the possibility to post questions. The questions will be sent to me just in time. I will collect all the questions and I will forward it later on to the speaker, who will be more than happy to give you an answer on your issues after the end of the presentation. The session will be recorded, which means the session will be put online in 2 or 3 days' time. And if you would like to view the webinar again or would like to share it with other colleagues, the webinar will be recorded accessible on the Foodstar webpage. So what is EU Foodstar about? It's an Erasmus Plus Knowledge Alliance project, which is in the finalization phase right now. You see here, December 2017, we got an extension until March from the European Union. So we are now in the very last phase of the project. Today's last EU Foodstar webinar within the project. The Food Science and Training Alliance would like to overcome the gap between food industry and universities, to overcome the different demands, and we would like to close and bridge the gap between basic fundamental research and applied research, applied solutions on the food industry sites. Publication versus APR, time constraints versus time for basic research. You all know maybe this discussion emissions, and we would like, with this food start, to give a contribution to closing this gap. We would like to have long-term partnerships on European level, and we would like to have clear, simple goals and not too high expectations in the end of the project. Sorry for the interruption. I just got the information that the voltage is not inserted. So the consortium comprises of 7 universities, 3 food companies, 11 multipliers and training providers. We have 11 multipliers and training providers. We have Boco, Agrobaritech, Politecno, Coimbra, GB Foods, EFOS, Dania, and lots more. I do not want to emphasize all of them right now. You can see the huge geographical distribution of this European-wide Food Star network we have. And of course, we have this European access for the project. As I mentioned, we have a lot of universities there. We have also a number of food companies there. We have Frulact in Portugal, a multinational in fruit preparations. We have GB Foods there, also a multinational company from Spain with a lot of business units somewhere. And we have as accompanying partner company Nestle as worldwide acting fruit producer giving feedback on the needs of the industry within the Food Star network. To be excessive for all of you, we also have a number of multipliers and training providers inside the consortium, also comprising from private nonprofit research institutions, from food federations, also student and teachers networks, and EFOST and the Eroica for the industry and student issues. Food Star is not somewhere in the air. It's not only a virtual construct, it's also bottom-down constructed with physical hubs in a number of countries for Paris, Hohenheim, Vienna, Athens, Barcelona, Teramo, Porto and Leeds. These are physical hubs where people are sitting, being able to be contacted, being able to interaction with you and have this access via industry and via the academia side. What is needed to enhance Europeans' innovation capacity? We have regional corporations, a number of regional corporations with clusters and competence centers, and Food Star will be a kind of network over the networks to have this European net to be interactive with a number or many of these existing networks to have clear and fast and effective contact for the exchange of needs and also for the exchange of solutions, which means we have a number of members from external as well. We have training providers, universities, and also associated project partners. And all these partners come in the Food Star network, are actively participating in the network, and also are exchanging solutions, applied research solutions, also needs from the university, from the industry. And Food Star membership is free. If you would like to apply and be part of our growing, fast-growing EU, and I would also say more or less worldwide network, then apply at food-star.eu. So much for the project, and now we come back to the presentation you are urgently waiting for. We are now giving over the screen to Marie-Christine Champomier-Berger. She is Research Director at INRA, and she has high expertise in food microbiology, ecology, food and meat ecosystem, and so on and so on and so on. Today's speech will be about biopreservation of foodstuffs, and mechanisms and applications. And we are eagerly waiting for your slides, Marie-Christine. And I will now reopen your microphone. And I will also once again give back the screen to you and good luck for the presentation. Once again, for the participants, please use the possibility to post questions because later on we will discuss all these questions together with the presenter. Marie-Christine?
Yes.
The screen should be yours.
Thank you, Julian, for the introduction, and good afternoon to all. I am happy to share with you this presentation about biopreservation, not foodstuffs, not food star, mechanism and applications. So, I will start with a short introduction, and I will present you the actors of this biopreservation, also their roles and play, and also I will present some future trends, especially in research in this topic. So, what is biopreservation? Well, it has been defined in 1996 by Michael Stiles, and he refers he said that biopreservation refers to extended storage life and enhanced safety of foods using natural microflora and or their antibacterial product. Lactic acid bacteria have a major potential for use in biopreservation because they are safe to consume, and during storage they naturally dominate the microflora of many foods. In milk, brine vegetables, many cereal products, and meats with added carbohydrate, the growth of lactic acid bacteria produces a new food product. In raw meat and fish that are still stored under vacuum or in an environment with elevated carbon dioxide concentration, the lactic acid bacteria become the dominant population and preserve the meat with hidden fermentation. That was exactly the word used by Michael Stiles in 1996. So let's see now what can we see about 20 years later about this definition and what can we see about this biopreservation. In fact, when we look at the underlined item, meaning extended storage life, enhanced safety, natural microflora, antimicrobial products, lactic acid bacteria, new food product, chill stored, it's clear that it refers to the food ecosystem. And as any other ecosystem, this food ecosystem could be considered by three parts. First, the resources, meaning here in this case, the food matrix, which represents nutrients for the growth of microorganisms. Also, another part of any ecosystem is the environment. In the case of food, we will say that it can be the process, meaning the condition encountered during this process, temperature, pH, gas, additives. And also, last but not least, the living being in this ecosystem, meaning the microbiota. If we see the food bacterial microbiota, what can we say about this bacterial living here? Well, we can say also that three big clusters can be made. On the part, some bacteria can be considered as pathogens in this microbiota. Some other one will be seen as spoilers of this food, but also other one are beneficials. And what is important is that in each of these categories, there is a high diversity of species. And also the abundance of these different bacterial species varies in this different category. Also, there is a dynamic during the storage and process, and sometimes the border is not so clear, meaning what is the spacious status. In some cases, some bacteria can be considered as spoilers and detrimental for the food, but in other cases, meaning in other food matrices, they can be considered as beneficial. So we have to keep in mind all this aspect of the diversity of bacteria in our food, either to more understand this biopreservation. And if we go deeper and we try to understand what's happened with these microorganisms when they grow in food, all these microorganism community, well, we all know that the growth of this community can be a risk, either for the people eating the food and can lead to illness, of course, but also a risk for the food, meaning leading to spoilage. But don't forget and keep in mind that the growth of microorganisms is often a benefit for the food and the people they eat the food. Meaning, in case of the fermentation, the growth of some beneficial microorganism leads to new product. It's different from the fresh products, meaning a sausage is different from pork meat. But also, in other cases, stands a growth of bacteria, which leads to preservation without modifying the product, meaning the same product is here, but the difference is that it's still chill stored. And this is where the biopreservation is mainly active for the conservation, the preservation of fresh product. So we have these microorganisms in food. We have this biopreservation, and we agree that biopreservation aims at limiting growth or survival of unwanted microorganisms, meaning pathogens and spoilers. Also, biopreservation aims at limiting production or amounts of undesirable compounds. In order to lower chemical treatments, preservatives such as natrium chloride, nitrites, and at regarding this aspect, we can say that biopreservation can support the clean label. And also, this biopreservation can improve organoleptic properties, safety, shelf life, and also can reduce waste and losses. And regarding this, we can say that there is a green label of this biopreservation. So, well, we say it's important for food technology to develop this biopreservation. But as we've seen, the aims are different, and the bacteria we have to suppress or to lower are different, meaning in the cases of pathogens, more often it's one species which is undesirable, and this species is often in low number by chance. And to fight these species, we need specific tools, dedicated tools. And for example, bacteriocene are specific tools that are good tool for limiting growth of pathogens. But in the case of spoilers, this is different. In fact, lots of different species are generally acting for promoting the spoilage of food, and they are often present at high level. So the strategy will be different, and we will have to act on the competitiveness of strain that will be added in the food to be competitive against these different species which are present in high level. For all these reasons, you see that it's important to know well the bacterial communities, and I insist on it. We have to know very well the bacteria present in our food, because if we want to use biopreservation, which is an hurdle technology to limit all these pathogens and spoilers, we have to develop this ecological strategy. And that's what's happened through the last years and through the past. Because if we see the evolution of the biopreservation strategies among during the, let's say, the 20 years ago, first, the biopreservation was rather dedicated to target pathogen, starting with screening in lab medium, screening for bacteria able to lower the growth of the pathogen, but it was generally dedicated to one species, and generally one single strain were used and proposed, especially by the production of bacteriocene. Now, the trend is a little bit different, because we now try to have a global food microbia characterization, relying on the development of the new generation sequencing method, and that gave us new insight in the bacteria we are arbor in foods. And also we try to exploiting the genomic diversity of the biopreserver, the bacteria that can be used as biopreserver. And the new strategy are rather based on fitness and ecology. Which product can be targeted with this biopreservation? As I said before, you can mean that can be fresh products stored at low temperature, meaning dairy, meat, or fish product, or product from plants. For example, that can be shrimps, or ground meat, or carpaccio, but also fresh cheese, soft cheese. And there are lots to do about protection of this food. But also in fermented food, in dairy and meat industry, meaning in the case of sausage or cheese. Lots of applications have been dedicated mainly for fighting development of pathogen, for example. But also the biopreservation can be applied to processed food in cooked or dried after the process. You can imagine to add some bioprotective culture in ham, for example, in order to improve the shelf life. There are here some examples of commercial application that you can find on the web. And for example, in the case of dairy product, main important companies such as Danisco, DuPont, for example, have some product that they recommend for the growth control of some bacteria, Leconostoc, Lactobacilli, and you can see the application they propose. They also propose some product for the growth control of Listeria. This is true for dairy product, but also for fish product. And for example, you can see here the proposition of the Sacco company with a protective culture for fish processing, and they specify that this culture is made of Carnobacterium, which are producers of bacteriocin that inhibit the growth of Listeria monocytogenes in fish product. And also they say that this has been developed with a researcher. So if this is true for the large companies, but also small companies that propose protective lactic acid bacteria ferment to ensure or extend the shelf life by inhibiting the growth of spoilage bacteria, meaning that can be coliform pseudomonas or lactic acid bacteria, or also for Listeria monocytogenes. This is the case of a small company in France. And also you can find some other company that propose, also the great company such as Chr. Hansen, that propose some culture that are both able to make acidifications, meaning also to perform the fermentation, but also the prevention of the growth of Listeria by the production of the bacteriocin. So you can see that there are diverse ways of using this biopreservation culture, and there are lots of applications that are proposed at the commercial. But how does it work? Which bacteria are present? What can we say? What's happened? What are the role of this different bacterial culture? What can we see about the biopreservation? Preserver, meaning the bioprotective culture. As mentioned first 20 years ago by Michael Steels, yes, it's true that lactic acid bacteria are really good candidates because they belong to the natural flora or lots of nutrient-rich niches, such animals, plants, humans, and also for subsequently from our food. Also, as you know, they can perform spontaneously the fermentation of food. And one also what we can appreciate in the case of lactic acid bacteria is that there are qualified presumption of safety, or also named GRAS, generally recognized as safe, meaning that we can eat them without any problem. That is to say that we can put them in the food and it should not be a problem to use this bacteria. Also, we know that these bacteria, they have a wide genomic diversity generally, also a wide subsequently a wide metabolic diversity. And that's interesting for all this metabolite production, meaning organic acid, hydrogen peroxide, antimicrobial compounds such as bacteriocin, all this metabolite that will be of interest for fighting against unwanted bacteria. It happens naturally in the food and in the habitat where they live, but we have, as researcher and future user of biopreservative culture, to know more that we produce and how it works in order to more use these resources. Also, we know that these bacteria are really competitive in their environment and they can perform competition for resources. And as you remember, it was important in the case of biopreservation that these bacteria can compete, and especially for fighting against spoilers. And in this case, we can consider that they represent a good hurdle for the development of other unwanted bacteria. These lactic acid bacteria that are used for bioprotective culture mainly belong to the Lactobacillus genus, which encompasses more of 2,000 species, Lactococcus, and also Carnobacterium. And I will show you some examples of these lactic acid bacteria used for the bioprotection later in the presentation. Regarding pathogens targeted by biopreservation, well, a few species are considered, meaning the most emblematic species that has been deeply studied is Listeria monocytogenes, and many tentatives have been made, and also with success, to fight this Listeria monocytogenes, especially with the selection of bacteriocin active against this species. But also it's true for Escherichia coli, Salmonella, and also Staphylococcus aureus, which are the pathogens that are targeted. Regarding spoilers and spoilage, well, the story is a little bit different because spoilage is a very complex phenomenon, meaning many volatile organic compounds can be produced by spoilage microorganisms, as you can see, for example, in the case of rhomid on this scheme that shows the different orders that can and volatiles that can produce during the spoilage. And also many spoilage organisms are involved in this production of volatile. For example, as you can see on the right part, you can see that, for example, some Pseudomonas are really active in producing esters, but they are not so much active for producing aldehydes, and it's different in case of other products, meaning it's really complicated to see who does what in the spoilage. And it's important to have a deep microbial characterization, the whole microbial characterization of the spoilage in order to be able to fight the unwanted microorganism. This better microbiota characterization can be achieved by the metagenomics and the NGS sequencing approach that this last year have been really developed, especially in the case of gut microbiota, but also in the case of microbiota of food. For example, I will show an example of a French project funded by the ENEA, the National French Agency of Research, in which we studied the natural flora of fresh food from meat and fish, for cooked shrimp, cod fillet, salmon fillet, smoked salmon, ground veal, ground beef, poultry, sausage, and diced bacon. And what can we see on this graph? By studying the microbiota, meaning studying by whole global ecosystem analysis, by 16S RNA analysis, you can see on the part, but the red part means a great abundance of bacteria. You can see here the different bacteria, name of the bacteria, you can see it, but and in green, meaning the lower abundance of these bacteria. What can we see? We can see that some species are shared by all type of food, meaning this general core of bacteria is found in all food we tested, meaning also fish and meat. Some other species that are presented here are rather present only in meat sample, meaning we call it the core mean. Also, on the same, you have a core siphon, meaning some species are present in meat, other one are not present in the fish. you also can see that there are some specific core, meaning the poultry sausage is characterized by the type of bacteria, and also diced bacon by the another one. You can see that there is a large diversity, for example, in the diced bacon, and also the bacteria typical of the cooked shrimps are different from the one present in salmon fillet. These species are present at the beginning of storage, meaning in fresh product, and we observe that up to 150 OTU, meaning species, could be present in one product. But what happened when we considered the spoilage? Well, at time where the product were spoiled, with the same application, you see that less species are present. 15 to 16 species present in spoiled product, meaning 15 to 20 days storage. Well, it's less, but also it's important, meaning 16 species contributing to spoilage is difficult if you want to find a protective culture. What was new also in this story, as you can see with the red star, you can see that, for example, this species was highly present in some meat sample. And we observe that this species was unsuspected in meat. So it was not used and was not tested by cultivation. And also, with the showed by this blue star, we found a species highly abundant and that was specific to the spoiled cod fillet. And this species was highly abundant, present, but it is referred as yet uncultured. So you can understand that it's difficult to decipher about the spoilage. So, regarding this actor, now try to see some mechanism of action of the bioprotection. Something that was done in the past and works, for example, inhibition of Listeria monocytogenes with a bacteriocin-producing cyanobacterium. You've seen it, it's produced, it's sold in the commercial. For example, the cyanobacterium divergens strain produced a bacteriocin named diversin, and the otters, they produced a mutant unable to produce the diversin, and they tested in smoked salmon in challenge states. And it's clear that Listeria monocytogenes, when it is cultured in the presence of the cyanobacterium divergens unable to produce the bacteriocin, well, this cyanobacterium can grow better than when the can grow higher than when the bacteriocin is present. So this means that the bacteriocin produced by C. divergens is active in the salmon, smoked salmon, and can prevent the growth of Listeria monocytogenes. Another nice example, another mechanism is the inhibition of Staphylococcus aureus by Lactococcus garvii through a different mechanism, meaning H2O2 production. In fact, the growth inhibition of Staphylococcus aureus was observed in milk and cheese. This in vitro inhibition was modulated by the level of aeration of the medium. And the inhibition was higher when Garvier produces H2O2. Transcriptomic analyses were performed in order to see which genes were expressed. And the response of Lactococcus Garvier to the aeration level differs according to the presence of absence of Staphylococcus aureus, meaning that the protective culture react to the presence of the pathogens. In fact, higher concentration of H2O2 with high aeration was not associated with a higher expression of H2O2 synthesis genes response, but rather with a repression of the Lactococcus garvii H2O2 degradation genes, meaning TRX, B1, HPC, HPF, and GPX. Well, this was an original, previously undiscovered H2O2 production regulation that has been nice study by this group and recently published. And they also the author also proposed that maybe, you know, the extracellular factor could be involved. And so it's quite different from the bacteriocin. Another case is the inhibition of spoilage by Lactococcus pisium. In fact, it was observed in lab condition, a shrimp spoilage prevention improving sensory quality by Lactococcus pisium. This was strain dependent, and the authors observed in vitro inhibitory activity against a large number of spoilage bacteria, meaning Borcotrix, Cyanobacterium, Lactobacillus, Vagococcus, Enterococcus, Cytobacter, Chironella, Pseudomonas. And they tried to make it in a food matrix, and they realized that inhibition of Borcotrix thermos factor in food matrix, salmon and shrimps, was okay, in fact, as you can see. But it was difficult to reproduce in vitro, meaning the inhibition was clearly efficient in the matrix. But when they try to perform it in the lab in order to understand what happens, they couldn't reproduce. So it was difficult to find the mechanism. So it's a little bit different because they try to test against pathogens. And in that case, it's interesting that they discovered that inhibition of Listeria by Lactococcus pisium was quite original, including a contact-dependent mechanism. In fact, this strain, the Lactococcus pisium, was able to inhibit the Listeria monocytogenase in shrimps. They tried to reproduce a shrimp's model by creating an in vitro chemically defined medium. And what do they observe? They observe that in a diffusion, you can see here, for example, the growth of the monocytogenes, and you can see that this growth is delayed when the strain is cultivated in the presence of Lactococcus pisium. But when this study is made in the diffusion chamber, no more inhibition, meaning that a contact is dependent. So that's surprising. That was surprising for the author, and it's probably a new and different mechanism, probably relying on a cell-cell communication mechanism that has not been elucidated for the moment. Another example that can illustrate the difference in the mechanism by which the protective culture can act is the inhibition of E. coli and salmonella in meat by a Lactobacillus sacchii cocktail. In the case of ground beef, you know that E. coli and salmonella are relevant pathogens, bacteria that are particulated unwanted. And Lactobacillus sacchii belongs to the natural flora of this fresh beef meat, and also is used as a starter. In these cases, the author based their strategy on the analysis of the genomic diversity of strain of Lactobacillus sacchii, and they perform cocktail. They said we won't use only one strain, but we try to have more efficiency by using cocktail of strain. So they mix different strain with different genetic contents, and they could observe that there was effect on growth of this pathogen. You can see the E. coli reduction, for example, was in that case 2.5. log, and it's also true for the salmonella. So they could perform a reduction and inhibition of growth of the pathogens. They also could perform the complementarity of the quantification of the different sacchii strain in their ground beef. And that's important because we don't know always if the strain that we add in food, especially, can grow and develop, and if the strain that we are the strain that we put at the beginning, because we talk at the beginning about the ecosystem and the competition between the bacteria. And with the genomic characterization, they were able to quantify the different strain, and they could observe that they grow not at the same rate, but they were all present And the hypothesis is that there is a strange complementarity, probably, between the different functions expressed by these three strands that can explain the effect on the growth of pathogen. Also, the ability to quantify strain is important for the traceability. Another example is to define a strategy for the selection of protective culture to improve food quality and safety. The author presented here their strategy for, let's say, we have selected target microorganism, pathogenic or spoiling microorganism. How can we perform the best selection of protective culture? So they try to collect different known, previously known protective culture, commercial, private collection. They selected it by inhibition of target of bacteria in model condition. And also they check for taxonomy, physiology of this strain. And then for safety and technology, a resistance to lyophilization production of also for this strain. Of course, one step that is also important is the absence of spoiling capacity in sterile food. And we try to inhibit the target in sterile food by challenge tests. And then they try to validate in naturally contaminated product in order to propose to the industry some protective culture. So what do we observe? Well, we can say that it's difficult to establish links between microbiota, sensoric ability, and protective culture. Meaning, they tested it for cold smoked salmon. They selected four specific spoilage bacteria that has been previously found as dominant in spoiled product, meaning Photobacterium, Serratia, Procotrix, and Carnobacterium. They tested six different protective culture, as previously described. We observed that the effect was different depending on target strains. They tested it in sterile food matrix, and they show that one of them, the Lactococcus pisum, prevents spoilage by two strains. But in the natural ecosystem, the results were totally contrasted. In fact, we observed no correlation between sensory improvement in microbial ecosystem cells. Meaning, and you can see on the left part that two batches here are presented. You are the name and the presence of the bacteria that have been modified by the addition of culture protective, bioprotective or controlled. This has been analyzed by 16x RNA perosequencing. You can observe that in the two batches, the results are a little bit different. You can observe also that if the bacteria have been selecting to target one specific or two or four organism, they can have an effect on other bacteria that was present in the natural ecosystem. And that was surprising also in this study and also made it difficult to conclude is that in the uppercase, case A, in the control, well, the bacteria were developed and the sensory analyses were clearly bad. In the bioprotective assay, the sensory analyses were improved, but it was a little bit naughty also. In the second, they had different results, meaning the controls was really bad, but the bioprotected the bioprotected test proved to have an improved sensory quality. So it's difficult from this to make a clear link between the presence of some bacteria, the sensory quality observed, and the protective culture. I just would like to highlight a new part of the mechanism that are now being studied more and more, but I won't go deeper in detail for this, meaning the antifungal properties of some strain. And for example, it's in this nice work, the people of the screen for antifungal property, and it's especially relevant for food from vegetal origins, and they observe that this screening, this property diseases were due to lactic acid and phenylacetic production, and they tested it in oat-based beverage by fermentation, and they could select one Lactobacillus plantarum strain that was able to improve the antifungal properties of that was able to improve the sensory quality of the oat beverage by fermentation. So that clearly represent new trend for selection of bioprotective culture. Sorry. In conclusion, what can we say? That the bioprotection is a complex phenomenon implying multiple factors and actors. There are interaction between the bacteria resident in the natural ecosystem and the bioprotective culture, and it's difficult to know it actually. There are no general mechanism, meaning no universal solution for any product you mean. But raising the question, is it necessary to have specific development for each product? What is also to keep in mind is that we need to have an ecological strategy, and especially to go deeper in the analysis of the black box of spoilage that is really complicated. It's also important to have traceability of the strain we can put inside the food to be sure of the effect performed by this strain are due to the presence of this food. And also, it's important to compare what is from lab and what is in the food, from lab to food, from food to lab. Based on this, what are the future trends we can draw? In fact, we can grow that it's important to combine hurdles, and it's a thing that has been which is done now in an INR project where we try to combine HHP treatment and biopreservation. Also, it's important to combine strain. You saw an example. Also, it's important to work on dynamics of bacterial community, and that is done by the global ecosystem analysis. Also, it's important to keep in mind to analyze the relation of pathogen and the other bacteria of the ecosystem. What we do now is all in the research lab is also to target the expressed function by the bacteria, and especially the bacteria when we are directly in food. That's a great advantage of the method developed by metatranscriptomic meta-analysis. We can perform now them directly in the food matrix, so we can target the function expressed directly in the food. And also, the trend is to measure the metabolite, meaning the metabolomics approach is important in order to decipher about the spoilage. Another question that has been not evocated here, but it is also relevant, is the question of European reglementation, meaning can we add bacteria in some fresh protein, such as meat, for example? And to work in that sense, it is important to make network with researcher and industry. And it's what we did through a French structure, which is a RMT named FLORPRO. RMT is a French joint technical network, labeled by the French Agricultural Ministry. And it encompasses technology institutes, such as Actalia, Aerial, EDIV, and IFIP, and also research institutes such as INRA and also IFREMER, and education such as AgroParisTech, which is a partner of the Foodstuff project, ONERIS, University of Liège. And the coordinator is Swad Christians from ADIF. And by this relation between a researcher and the different actors of the biopreservation, the action are to set up R&A programs that are coherent with professional expectation, being in link with the professional demand. We try to contribute to European reglementation for bioprotective culture and also communication and dissemination of all the knowledge acquired on bioprotective culture, information and training days, colloquium, publication in technical and scientific journal. And for example, this webinar and the presentation I did today with the support of the ARMT. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Marie-Christine. I will now take back the moderator's rights to me. So, and I will start my webcam right now. I hope you can see me. Yeah, hello here.
No, I
again.
Can't. I can see you.
You can't. The rest of the world can see me, but you can't. I know. Thank you very much for this very interesting presentation about the potential and the possibilities of your technologies you used. I just wanted to ask you two questions. In your slides, in your presentation, you mentioned sensoric aspects. And for me, it looked very promising and very good that there is no correlation between sensoric aspects and the substances you used. Is this a statement you can state generally for biopreservation, or does this only correlate to the examples you showed in your slides?
Well, generally, what we do is that before testing any bioprotective culture, I can see me, we test it for a potential effect on the sensorial activity and sensorial quality. And I must admit that sometimes we cannot use some culture because their effect is not so good. So it really depends on the natural ecosystem we are faced to. But I think the great lesson, no generality can be drawn for this biopreservation. We have to make some fine tunings and to dedicate solution by knowing the place, knowing the environment, knowing the bacteria, and try to do the best. So sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't work. And in some cases, the sensory quality were not so good with the bioprotective culture.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for this answer. Each research somewhere has the cutting edge. So I just wanted to ask you, where do you see limitations for the application? You mentioned that there are some already available products and technologies on the market. Do you see any limitation, or do you think that this can be provided with no limits further on in the next in the near and next future?
I think that if we want to develop more biopreservation, we need more fundamental study on knowing what happens in food. Because as you've seen, we cannot have universal and magical solution. I think it's, well, actually it's expensive to imagine that you will have to develop a specific solution. But we can imagine that in the next future, it will be easier to characterize your food microbiota and to decipher about the good bacteria that can be added once you know which bacteria are present, which is the environment, and the ideal would be to have a model that can predict to you that this bacteria could be good in this. Well, we are far from it, but we try to do in that direction, and I think it's the direction. Actually, this is the limit, because we have to do this kind of things for each product, and it's expensive, and we cannot imagine that one bacteria will be the perfect solution for all. But we have an enormous genomic diversity and genetic diversity in the lactic acid bacteria, meaning in the lab research, but also in the company. I think that the fridge and the freezer are full of sleeping beauties bacteria that could be very interesting. So we need to have this high throughput analysis of the potential of bacteria. And in this condition, maybe we will be able to have a bioprotection solution adapted and not too expensive.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for this clarification. In this very moment, I received one question from the audience. I also forwarded it to you. I will read it now, and you can be able to answer.
I can read it. You forwarded it to me? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I forwarded it, and you should see it in the question window. I will now read the question also for the other participants. At the moment, under member states, according to European legislation, if it's possible to use bacteriocins, a strategy in packaged poultry meat to improve the shelf life. So the question is it possible, according to the current European legislation, to use bacteriocins for packet poultry meat? Do you have any information about the status?
I haven't any direct information on it. To my knowledge, the only bacteriocin that can be used is niacin. It's a bacteriocin which is allowed to, but the case of fresh poultry meat is the case of all fresh meat. I think that meaning is it allowed to add something in fresh meat? I think that actually the European law doesn't allow to add something in fresh meat. It's not fresh meat if you add something. So maybe some bacteriocin can be active, maybe some strain that are able to produce bacteriocin directly in poultry meat could be active and efficient. I'm not sure, but I'm not a specialist of the regulation and the legislation. Sorry, I'm not sure it's presently allowed.
Mm-hmm. But thank you very much.
It is to be checked.
Mm-hmm. We have another accessing question. Are there any life cycle assessment results for the biopreservation of foodstuffs? Life cycle assessment, yes or no?
It is in progress. It is in progress because it is also, as you can imagine, also a limiting thing, especially if we have to dedicate some specific culture. And I know that some work is in progress actually in some lab in France, but I think but we are trying to do it and to assess this.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. We have a next question, which will be forwarded in this very second. Bacteriocins would be an additive and would need permission according to the EU regulation. This is not the question, this is the answer to the question.
Yes, I think.
Thank you very much, Mr. Lücke. And he would like to comment on the legal situation. We will see if this is possible, if I can open up his microphone. Mr. Lücke, are you there? Can you hear us? Can you talk to us?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much. You would like to give a comment on the legal situation, please. Yeah, the floor is yours.
I've been a little bit involved in this, especially in the meat sector, having worked on some bioprotective cultures also about many years ago. I think as soon as you add bacteriocin as such, it would need clearance according to the EU regulations. So it would be far from realistic to do so. If you use a bacteriocin producing culture, because then it's slightly different. Show that the culture is safe, then of course you can use it, but the question is whether you have to label it or not. And then and normally you would at least if the culture is expected to do some still work on the in the final product, then it's not a process aid, you would have to label something like protective culture or whatsoever.
Yeah.
That's at least the legal situation in Germany. But I think in the European level it should be similar, but I'm not sure. But maybe in France the legal situation is different. But in Germany this is very strong, the difference. If some additives does something in the final product, say inhibiting listeria or so, then you would have to label it. so it would not help you in using the list of additives in the, on the list. But I would be interested to learn about the situation, for instance, in France. So that's for my comments about the legal situation. Mm-hmm.
I think it's the same. In fact, in France, it's difference between the product bacteriocin and also the culture. But in the case, is specificity is the case of fresh meat. And in fresh meat, for the moment, we are not allowed to add some bacteria. It's true. It's true.
Okay. Thank you very much for this clarification and also for the experience from the German side. I think this is also what we face here in Austria. And I will say generally in Europe that the appliance of innovation related to food law is very restrictive. I have another two last questions before we come to the end of the webinar. I will forward it to you, Marie-Christine. The first one, what are the perspectives of biopreservation in vegetables and fruits? There will be a possible application in kind of products like these vegetables and fruits.
Yes, I think that's it's a new area for biopreservation. I just mentioned the case of the plantarum with antifungal properties, and I think that actually a lot of work is dedicated to this kind of fermentation, but also to biopreservation of fruit. And especially in the case of fruit, I think that the bacteria, it's not bacteria that are targeted, but rather molds. And in that case, the fungal properties are now being tested. And I think that some people and some groups try to develop this approach. And especially at University de La Réunion, in the Health of La Réunion, they try to select some protective culture for the protection of tropical fruit. And this is a large area with different questions because the ecosystem is different and because the targeted strains are also different. No more pathogens, rather molds and fungus. Yes, it's being done.
Okay, thank you very much. And pre-last question, according to your experience, how big is the hidden potential of bacteria to produce bacteriocins only in co-culture and in physical contact with other bacteria? So what's
I'm
your
not
opinion
sure
on
to
that?
Understand the hidden potential for the production of bacteriocin, only bacteriocin? No.
Mm-hmm.
Can you repeat? Just for bacteriocins?
According to your experience, how big is the hidden potential of bacteria to produce bacteriocins only in co-culture and in physical contact with other bacteria?
I have not directly experienced this question, but I would say that due to the large amount of bacteriocins that are produced, and there are probably some if we consider that bacteriocin are some communication modes between cells, probably most are acting through this mechanism. There was a large survey on the bacteriocin present in the genome of different lactobacilli that has been published in 2014, I guess, about the genetic potential of lactobacillus. And they explore all the bacteriocin genes that were encoded by this genome of the bacteria. And I think that deeper analysis on this genome and bacteriocin gene would probably give information. It's not my experience because I have no experience of the tissue. It's my feeling. My feeling is that we have lots to know about the genomic diversity to understand what could happen and to make some model of prediction between the bacteria. And try to make some new ecology in order to predict the reaction between the different species. And bacteriocin is typically something which must be considered not for biopreservation, but for a system of communication between cells. And probably we can have information from this and then understand how by how could biopreservation with bacteriocin could be more efficient? Because the problem of bacteriocin is that in some cases they have been really promising in lab studies, but in the food matrix it's sometimes difficult to have the same results.
Thank
so now
much.
We have to work directly in food matrix and directly with the whole ecosystem. It's what I see, my feeling.
Thank you very much for your feelings. And as these are the feelings of a scientist, we will trust in your feelings. last question.
Thank you for allowing me to share my feelings with you.
Last question before we come to the very end of the webinar. We have a last question of what do you think of the use of bacterial phag? So bacterial phages, is this possible? What do you think about this? Is there a potential on this?
I think also there's a for the same reason there is a potential. Some nice application have been done. I don't know very well this field of phage, but I think that the regulation and legislation in Europe, I don't know if they allow this use of phages, but I think that in terms of ecology and efficiency, some results are promising in the lab. That could be done maybe larger. Yes, I think.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we will see, maybe in the upcoming years, we can do a webinar about the use of phages.
Yes, some people are more probably qualified than me. That's my specialty of phage, but I trust can be a good resource. Yeah.
So once again, thank you very much for this very interesting webinar. I will now
show
your webcam and mine, and I hope that at least you can see my screen right now, because I just would like to point your attention. Can you see my screen?
Yes. Upcoming past webinars.
Yeah, upcoming webinars. So this is the hint for our attendees. If you would like to follow the series of EU Foodstar webinars, you just click on your Internet Explorer, your Web Explorer, www.food-star.eu, and then you go to the events and webinars page, and there you can see the whole list of webinars which were carried out under the EU Foodstar project. And until tomorrow, you can see here our webinar of today. It will switch to past webinars. And if you just click on one of the past webinars, you can see the description, and below you can find the recordings and the presentations. So we are now coming to the final end and the closing of the webinar. Thank you, all of the participants. Thank you very much for your interest in today's webinar. And I hope we will meet each other in one of next webinars to topics of food science, food law, or other related topics. I will now finally end the webinar, stop the recording, and I wish you a good morning, a good afternoon, and a good evening and good night to all our participants all over the world. Thank you for your interest in these webinars, and goodbye.